Denolagovich sends a super chat. He says, "JF, I listened to the stream yesterday whilst driving. The remark about Nazi fans is not just disingenuous, it is insulting. I knew little about this man, but now have a poor opinion of him." Yeah, I hope that it wasn't his last comment on the issue. But if that is his last, disappointing. I'm disappointed. People were saying, "JF, disappointed," on the regular chat. That is what I feel. I just feel... But it's been like this basically for all people I've ever respected in the intellectual domain. Because the Richard Dawkins, you know, I've been respecting him for his writing. But again and again, it has come to be a disappointment in terms of his ability to engage rationally in anything social science related. There's also a disappointment with Richard Dawkins with his obsession of putting woman forward at the cost of losing his own credibility. Like, Richard Dawkins still hasn't ever done a public comment on the revolutionary phenotype. Yet back in 2016, or, you know, back in maybe more than this, maybe 2015, he was promoting Jacqueline Glenn because, oh, she's a female and she's an atheist. Now, Jacqueline Glenn turned out to be a plagiarist who I've exposed. If you want to see some old school YouTube video, I don't know if I could find it.
Following is,
ladies and gentlemen, JF from 2015. I've been full-time streaming since then.
Series of revelations by multiple YouTubers, it appears that YouTube atheist celebrity Jacqueline Glenn has engaged into a series of acts of plagiarism over the...
Look at him. Look at this guy. Woman being promoted. You promoted someone who couldn't think, Richard. You promoted someone whose only way to elevate herself on the public space was to steal information from others through plagiarism.
The past 3 years. In this video, I summarize and analyze the current findings, and I add two new cases of plagiarism which were not discussed previously. Let us look at the historical context in which Jacqueline Glenn's plagiarism occurred. This is a graph illustrating the amount of views per month for Jacqueline Glenn's channel, summarizing her entire career. To help you situate yourself, consider that it is in June 2011 that Rebecca Watson and Richard Dawkins initiated Elevator Gate, and in which Richard Dawkins wrote the famous letter, "Dear Muslima." At this time, and in the year that followed, Jacqueline Glenn was still a relatively unknown YouTuber and a firm believer in God.
Like, my inbox was just flooding with, like, responses to my comment. People saying, you know, how can you claim to be a Christian and not to...
My accent changed a lot. I cannot believe this was my way of phrasing stuff. Unadulterated OG JF.
Support his statement. So that's what I want to make this video about. How I can claim that I am a Christian and completely have no respect for Rick Perry at all. But I believe in God. I'm not really like most Christians. I have my own little set of beliefs. And if you want me to make a video on that, leave a comment. I don't know why you would, because it's just how I feel.
So we can consider the whole period up to July 2012 as a period in which Jacqueline Glenn is a Christian. However, in July 2012, she starts posting some videos on richarddawkins.net in which she is more critical of religion.
So I think that I'm confusing a lot of people as to where I personally stand. And it's a really long story, so I'm going to try to condense it as much as I can to make the video short. So I started reading the Bible, and I saw, like, all these contradictory quotes, and no one could give me any answers. And the only answers I could get from people were hypocritical ones, like, oh, that's, you know, that's just, you have to take that as, like, a symbolism.
About a year later, in August 2013, Jacqueline's popularity explodes due to a series of videos about religion in which she takes an atheist stance. Gathering the support from important members of the atheist community, such as PZ Myers, and filming an interview with Richard Dawkins.
An idea of who we're talking about. Ray Comfort is the guy known as the Banana Man, and the reason for that is because he tried to argue that a banana is evidence of God because it's shaped so perfectly to fit in our hand.
We will label the whole period that precedes this ascension to success as the conversion period. Finally, we will label the peak of her career as the prominent atheist period during which she has been at the forefront of the YouTube atheism community. Now, it is interesting to consider the events of plagiarism that have been recently exposed on YouTube, including two new cases which will be later shown for the first time in this video. The interesting question is whether plagiarism came before success or the other way around. What came first, plagiarism or success? A plot of the events of...
This is good content. I don't know if you guys agree. Of course, it's a little easy for me to say that to a JF crowd, but... This is good fucking content. I want to know. So was it the plagiarism first or success first?
Plagiarism makes it clear that Jacqueline's copying of prominent atheist figures predates her success. As early as June 2013, Jacqueline plagiarizes three works before her channel had attained any major popularity. It is quite interesting to see how each act of plagiarism that has been uncovered seems to be followed by increases of the...
Go away says, whose video is this? It's my video. This is my behavioral reinforcement theory of Jacqueline Glenn. She plagiarized, she got rewarded with it. She plagiarized more, she got rewarded with it. She plagiarized more, she got rewarded with it. She had a drop, she plagiarized again, got rewarded with it. Little drop, plagiarize, goes up. This is beautiful. This is science. Jacqueline Glenn was pushed to the top by feminism, by desire to A, woman can do it too. And she exploited, parasitized this movement that was like, hey, we need good arguments coming from women. And she wasn't able to produce those good arguments, so she stole them. Me and plagiarism dates back a long time.
The view count of Jacqueline's channel in the 2 or 3 months that follow. This may indicate that Jacqueline was getting signals from her audience that plagiarized ideas would allow her to boost the popularity of her channel. Another argument suggesting that the plagiarized videos were pleasing is when we compare the average views of all of Jacqueline's videos with the average views for videos in which plagiarized content was found. The average video without plagiarism published by Jacqueline makes a total of 124,000 views.
Science, motherfuckers! Science! She was scoring higher on the YouTube scale with plagiarism. Her IDs were less interesting than the IDs she could steal.
As of December 2015, while the videos in which plagiarized content was found make up an average of 268,000 total views. That's more than twice the average number of viewers. This suggests that by plagiarizing content from other authors, Jacqueline was increasing the success of her channel and potentially increasing her income. This also means that Jacqueline was aware that plagiarism was paying off in terms of views. I was quite curious to know what happened in the months that preceded her first known acts of plagiarism, which seemed to have been a cornerstone in causing the success of her channel. This video, published 1 month before there was any sign that Jacqueline Glenn would become a leading YouTuber, explains the context very well.
So, I look awful, didn't have time to do anything, get ready for this video, whatever, but it's appropriate because I'm talking about body image, so I just, you know, who cares? And I feel awful, and the only reason why I'm smiling and acting like this is because I took a bunch of Adderall and caffeine, so yay for drugs!
So no biggie, she was just taking some Adderall and... Wait, what? This girl is as high as a kite! In the 3 days that preceded this video, Jacqueline expresses her love of a prescription drug called Adderall. On Twitter, she writes, I heart Adderall, with many hells.
Look at this, I was digging through Twitter, a tweet that had 2 likes. This is research, motherfuckers, this is research!
And on Instagram, she posts a picture of herself looking tough, reporting on Twitter, don't fuck with me on Adderall, this time with the correct number of L's, but many exclamation mark. She feels invincible. So here we need an interlude to talk about drugs. Adderall is truly the most pleasant prescription drug to be on. It's sometimes similar molecules to those sold as speed or amphetamines on the recreational drug market.
Why can't we have good things like this? Why does that not exist anymore on the internet?
It is used because it helps people with ADHD to concentrate and focus at school or at work. This is why it is also referred to as the study drug. Being on Adderall is a quite pleasant experience, and depending on the dose, it can become addictive. Users may experience feelings of intense well-being and euphoria. It is unknown if Jacqueline was taking this medication before, or if the onset of her consumption truly precedes her episode of plagiarism by only a month. To my knowledge, these tweets and this YouTube video
Look at this graph. Use of drugs. Plagiarism. Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. This is science happening right in front of your eyes. I mean, just looking at this temporal relationship, I was like, something is happening here. She started Adderall, or started at least talking publicly about it and celebrating getting it, and boom, she goes into massive plagiarism mode.
Are the only known reference to her use of this particular medication, and they all occurred in a relatively tight window of time, just before Jacqueline's success. It should be noted that other events for which we do not have precise dates may have occurred in this time period, including the abandonment of her studies for becoming a nurse. One interesting fact is that Jacqueline mentions that she has taken a bunch of Adderall. Very rarely will a physician prescribe a bunch of these pills. Patients are normally told to take a fixed number per day, generally one or two. So this opens the possibility that she may have been abusing Adderall at that time. In any case, the goal here is not to conclude that Adderall has caused the episode of plagiarism, but rather to develop an understanding of the context in which Jacqueline's popularity has exploded, a context in which her brain's reward center were hijacked by prescription drugs, and in parallel stimulated by the excitement of a growing YouTube fame that seemed to directly result from plagiarized content. It is important to consider that the events described up to now, including the first known acts of plagiarism, have occurred before there was any major sign of the upcoming rise in YouTube popularity for Jacqueline. So now let us look at the three cases of plagiarism that were found in a single video published in June 2013. Note that most of the cases of plagiarism described in this video were found by other people, and I have quoted these people wherever it was appropriate. In what follows, the statements of Jacqueline will be displayed on the left and the plagiarized source will be displayed on the right. The name of the person who discovered the plagiarism will be displayed at the bottom. The first case concerns the plagiarism of one internet author and two public personalities, Bill Maher and Stephen Fry.
The first god I want to go over is Horus. It was a god that was written about in the Egyptian Book of the Dead in 1280 BC, and here are some of the similarities. First of all, he was a son of God. All the old paintings. Some people disagree whether or not he was born of a virgin. But that's in some stories of him. He was baptized in a river. He was tempted in the desert. He healed the sick. Cured the blind. And cast out demons. Walked on water. He raised someone named Asar, A-S-A-R, from the dead. And that actually literally translates to Lazarus. He had 12 disciples. He was crucified and rose from the dead 3 days later. That's just a few things.
Man, I loved the Jacqueline Glenn research. Because this girl, you would find a nugget of plagiarism, and you would find the vein. And it would be like, oh, she plagiarized every word. And it's like, you would just, all you had to do is find one sentence, locate it somewhere. And then it was like, everything around it came to be plagiarized.
They didn't have that much in common.
But anyways, the next god I want to talk to you about is Krishna. Here are a few things that they had in common. Both the son of God, both sent from heaven to earth in the form of a man, both called the Savior, the second person of the Trinity. His adoptive father was a human and a carpenter. Both were visited at birth by wise men and shepherds, guided by a star. Both were without sin. They were both God-men, both being human and divine. Both performed many miracles, including healing disease, one of them being making a leper whole. Both cast out indwelling demons and raised the dead. Both selected disciples to spread his teachings. Both were meek and merciful. Both were criticized for associating with sinners. Both celebrated a Last Supper. Both forgave his enemies. Both descended into hell and were resurrected. Many people witnessed their ascensions into heaven. And that brings me to the last god, Mithra.
There are amazing things claimed about Mithras, and I'll read you some of them. He was a savior, Mithras.
Mithras was a Roman god. He was the savior.
Sent to earth to live as a mortal.
He was sent to earth to live as a mortal.
Through whom it was possible for sinners to be reborn into immortal life. He died for our sins, but came back to life the following Sunday.
He died for our sins so that sinners could have everlasting life. But of course, he was resurrected from the dead.
He was born of a virgin on December the 25th in a manger or perhaps a cave.
He was born from a virgin on December 25th.
Attended by shepherds and became known as the light of the world.
And guess what? He was born in a manger with lots of shepherds and they referred to him as the light of the world.
He had 12 disciples with whom he shared a last meal before dying.
He also had 12 disciples and they also had a last supper before he died.
His devotees symbolically consumed the flesh and blood of him.
The people who used to worship this god would have symbolic meals of his flesh and blood.
Because Mithras was a sun god, he was worshipped on Sundays.
Is he a tribute band?
He's often depicted with a halo around his head. And Mithraists gave each other gifts on December the 25th. The leader of the religion was called a papa, and their HQ was on Vatican Hill in Rome.
Pictures of him often depicted a halo around his head, and HQ was, guess what, on the Vatican Hill in Rome.
So here, as early as June 2013, we have evidence that Jacqueline Glenn is engaging in direct reading of written articles and direct retranscription of videos. Jacqueline has still not recognized these events publicly.
Would you say this is like the first time you've done that, or would you say that, you know, it's something you've done before, but you usually do it a little better?
Well, the thing is people have accused me of it before with a Facebook comment that I admitted to and then went back and credited. As far as videos and stuff, like this is not something that I do. Like, I do not watch people's videos and like write down what they say and repeat them. That's ridiculous.
So here, Jacqueline is lying. She does look at people's video and she does write what they say. So these three early cases of plagiarism allow us to add TV personalities Stephen Fry and Bill Maher to the list of plagiarized people, as well as author B.A. Robinson from religioustolerance.org. We will now have a look at the two following cases of plagiarism that occurred in October 2013. In these two instances, Jacqueline Glenn is reading almost word for word the Facebook comments of members of her audience.
Obamacare's law. It was passed by both the Senate and the House. It was signed by the President, upheld by the Supreme Court, and reaffirmed by the 2012 presidential election. I mean, if the Tea Party wants to advance their agenda, then maybe they should actually win national elections. Now, the House of Representatives are elected from districts, many of which are gerrymandered, and certainly a House representative does not speak for the majority of American voters. They only speak for voters in their districts. And it appears that a small fraction of one political party is being allowed to use extortion and hostage-taking in an effort to put an end to democracy in America, if you want to even call it that. And a lot of Americans are supporting this effort. You know what? It's not so much the political differences or the disagreement on different issues. It's that the Republican Party just seems to evolve ever more into a depth of apathy, irresponsibility, ignorance, and carelessness, and a willful degradation to the quality of life for human beings in America. It's not so much about the politics. It's about the protection of human rights that the GOP just continues to battle at every single fucking turn.
So these two instances allow us to add Dorothy Freeman and Idai Moya to our list. The following case is unclear about who Jacqueline Glenn plagiarized from. Her wording is very similar to a post on Yahoo Answers by Wacko Jacko. However, the post by Wacko Jacko was made a couple of days after the publication of Jacqueline's video, so it is unlikely that Jacqueline has plagiarized from the Yahoo Answers post directly. She may have taken it from somewhere else where Wacko Jacko would have posted before he posted it to Yahoo Answers. In any case, we know that this is a case of plagiarism because the wording used is very close to a statement made by Dave Muscato, which was reported on Facebook 5 days before Jacqueline posted her video. Thus, the only uncertainty is about whether Jacqueline plagiarized from Dave Muscato directly or from a post of Wacko Jacko on a yet-to-be-identified forum.
Keep your creation mythologies out of our science classes. Keep your God out of our governments. Keep it out of our pledge, off of our money, out of our state seals and courthouse oaths. Keep it out of our civil laws regarding abortion access, birth control access, and marriage equality. Keep it out of our sex ed classes. And stop using religion as an excuse to prevent the progression of scientific advancements, including stem cell research. Stop doing those things, and we'll have nothing left to say. Because 100% of what we fight for and what we say is in response to religious people. If they really did just believe what they want to believe and didn't push it on people, didn't affect other people's lives, didn't harm people, we would have nothing to say and I wouldn't be complaining, but that is not the world that we live in. We have to respond to what is coming at us and we have to deal with it. That's not something you can tell me to live and let live on.
Now let us have a look at the following event from January 2014 in which Jacqueline Glenn plagiarizes Sam Harris.
And, you know, we shouldn't be watching cartoonists have their lives threatened by people who can't tolerate jokes about the Prophet Muhammad.
Comedians, cartoonists, and YouTubers shouldn't have to worry about getting their lives threatened for making fun of Muhammad.
Well, I should be clear. In criticizing Islam, I'm not criticizing all Muslims.
I don't want to criticize every single Muslim.
There are Muslims who don't take the doctrine very seriously. There are Muslims who don't read the Quran with any attention.
Same thing in every religion.
Yes.
Yeah. I know that there are some out there that don't take it as seriously, just like in any religion.
And it's as though we're encountering the Christians of the 14th century, you know, armed with 21st century weapons.
But the problem is that it's like they're Christians of the 14th century with the technology and weapons of the 21st century.
Yeah, it's just, the problem is we just don't have 500 years to work it out.
But we don't have 500 or 600 years to figure this shit out.
We have incredibly destructive technology spreading all over the world, and it's getting increasingly easy for one person to screw up life.
All right, I can't play the whole video because there would still be 15 minutes of it. But I remembered this video yesterday as I was thinking about plagiarism, and perhaps we can have a look at the conclusion that I did back then.
We're also looking for conversion stories from people who once were Christians and later became atheists between September and December 2015. As you can see on the Google search result statistics, these two series of discoveries have resulted in increases in Google searches for Jacqueline Glenn. When the trolls are unleashed, the Google searches increase inevitably. In fact, the second wave of plagiarism discoveries has created as much interest as Jacqueline's photo shoot for Playboy in June 2015. Many questions remain unanswered. Are there still other cases of plagiarism to be discovered? Did Jacqueline's use of prescription drug have any impact on her creative abilities? Did drugs put her into a production mode where results and views were the only target worthy of her focus? I, for one, believe that Jacqueline Glenn has never truly been an intellectual, but that she was pushed into that role by the forces of the YouTube market and by leaders of the atheist community. After a series of events in 2011 and 2012, the atheist community was looking for prominent female speakers who could demonstrate that atheism is not reserved to white males, and leaders of the community were also looking for conversion stories from people who once were Christians and later became atheists. Jacqueline Glenn was the perfect candidate. She was young, female, beautiful, and her whole conversion history from Christianity to atheism was available on YouTube. But the leaders of the atheist community put her forward without doing their homework, and her work was not original. Soon, her limited ability to generate creative videos of her own on subjects relating to politics and atheism pushed her into plagiarism. Plagiarism was the only way to surf on the wave of YouTube fame that was sent her way by the atheist community, and to obtain the views that she wanted so hard. This is something to keep in mind next time they choose a poster child for the atheist movement, but that's a subject for another video. Thank you. following is...
That is beauty, my friends. The thieves, the plagiarists, the people who benefit from things without proper attribution, put to sleep, knocked down, eliminated, forever a trace of their actions left on the public space in beauty.
Thank you for watching this clip. This is the CAC of Lawfare. Remember to like and subscribe.